Hey, hey, hey. What's up?
What's up? What's up? What's up? What's up?
I almost forgot my lint roller microphone. Hey. What's up? How's everybody doing? I see the guest of honor is in the building. Hey, 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 hey. What's up, Bryan? Thank you for joining in, man. I'm gonna bring you in so we can vibe out. Hold it for a second. I'm having some technical difficulties and I don't know why.
You rocking, hey. Brother. I'm here for it. Hey.
we hat
twins as usual, too.
Hey, I'm feeling this hat, too, bro.
Thank you, brother. Thank you, brother. I'm feeling yours, too, man.
Thank you, sir. You know, style recognized style.
That's how we do. That's how we do.
Oh, wait, let's see who's in here. Hi, Stephanie. How you doing? Hey, welcome.
Hey, what's going on, peoples?
Mr. K. Winger. Hey, what's up, guys? Welcome in. True Faith. JSN. You're probably spelling it phonetically. Jason something. But I welcome you. Thank you so much. Jovid. Michelle. Welcome, guys. I'll turn the music down a little bit.
Hey.
You know, had to vibe a little bit. You know, I had to bring my brother in right.
Always. Always. That sounds of blackness, right?
Yeah, absolutely, man. It's appropriate.
Come on. As long as you keep your head
to the sky, we can end on that.
To the sky. But they don't hear us, though. They don't hear us, though.
Listen, where are you? What is this little setup? What's going on?
Oh, this is my office. I'm in Los Angeles right now. Yeah, I'm at the crib, man. A friend of mine is an interior designer. Shout out to Tacola Camille Designs.
Oh.
And as she was working on my crib, she's got this beautiful, like, ocean looking turquoise blue theme running through the whole house. But my favorite color is red.
Wow.
And I was like, I need some red. And she said, you can have it. You can have it in your office. So I'm in the office right now I call it the cigar room. So,
yeah,
I got this big old red plush cigar couch, and this is where the creativity is sparked, man. Red is a powerful energy.
Man, yes, it is. Absolutely. Yeah. And I'm telling you, it looks dope. It looks plush. It looks lavish.
Alexis Diaz in the house, my homegirl. What's up, Alexis?
Alexis, welcome. Welcome. My sister just logged in. Hey, what's up, Kim? How you doing? How you doing, sis? Love you. So listen, I just want to set some ground rules with people. Just, hey, welcome to my house. Thank you so much for coming and tuning in. But you got to take off your shoes, relax, open your mind. Hey, hey.
Relax, people.
But just relax and just chill. This is an environment of love and peace. And so if you ever see anyone in the comments talking strong and talking crazy, I give you full permission to yank them up and escort them out of my house, all right? Because this is a place of love, all right? So now that we have gotten that out of the way, I want to introduce you to my brother,
hey, man.
Bryan Terrell Clark is in the building.
Yeah.
This guy is so amazing, y'all. I'm so excited. On top of just being an amazing person, he has such an amazing spirit. And when we were introduced, just right off the bat, I was like, this is a good man. This is a good dude.
Wow.
This is a special person who has something special to say and share with the world. So just so you know, Bryan, these tailored talks that I created are just that. It's me speaking with special friends who have something special to give and something special to say and to share with the world. So you're just not just a random pick.
Wow, man. Well, I'm honored, man. I'm honored to be here. I mean, you know, it's an interesting time because, you know, everyone's connecting through social media and through cyberspaces right now. So a lot of the work that's being done and a lot of the purpose that I feel like I'm called to happens in these spaces. And so sometimes it's like, I don't know if I got the bandwidth to jump on. But brother, anytime you call, man, if I can answer, real talk, you got me. I'm here.
Let's I appreciate rock. It. Thanks so much, man. I sincerely appreciate it. So listen, sure. Guys, we met through a mutual friend of ours, Yvonne Orji, and we met at her birthday. It was her birthday party.
I think it was her birthday party. Yeah.
Birthday party. And Yvonne introduced us. And originally, I think she was just like, oh, yeah, this is Bryan, this is Donnell and Courtney. Like, their stylist, you know, this, that. He actually needs a stylist for something, a project that he's working on.
Yeah.
So we ended up talking and exchanging information. And if my memory serves me correctly, you had to leave early or something, right?
I think I did. I think I had to leave for birthday party. I might have had a show.
Yeah.
I feel like I had a show. I was doing Hamilton at the time.
Yes.
And I was, and I kind of like swung through because I have so much love. Shout out to Courtney, first of all. I think I saw her wave. Shout out to Courtney. And shout out to Yvonne Orji, who did her thing this season in Insecure. Y'all tackled some really powerful topics, so shout out to y'all. But yeah, we met through her, and I think I had to leave. I think it was the party. I think it was her birthday, and I think I had to leave early to get on stage. I think that's what it was. Yeah.
Oh, the quick conversation between you and I was basically you were remixing the song Quiet Uptown.
Uh-huh.
And you were wanting to, you know, be styled for your music video.
Yeah.
And so we briefly talked about it, and I was like, yeah, hit me up. So it happened. We connected, and I ran through so many, like, leaps and hoops and PR and, you know, people telling me no because I'm black.
Yeah.
I don't know if I should have said that. But
say it. Say it. Say it.
He's telling me no because I was black and I was styling a black actor and they just didn't think that it was appropriate for whatever. And yeah. I just remember reaching out to you and being like, I'm having a difficult time. Like, I'm having a difficult time pulling these looks and these items. You know I can...
Yeah.
Accessories of my own or things that I have in my Rolodex and in my closet. How do you feel about that? And I remember you being so gracious and being like, hey, I'm a stylish dude. So let's just style from my closet.
Let's do it.
And I was just like, whoa, okay. This is my guy. So
yeah.
We do it. The video is amazing. It looks great. Everything was amazing, and the song was amazing as well. So I'm just so glad that we got to collaborate on that level, and that, you know, we stayed in touch and connected ever since. Uh-oh, I think you're frozen. Oh, brother, bro, where you at? You caught up in the Matrix?
Oh, I'm back.
You there?
I'm here. Can you hear me?
Okay, cool. I was like, oh, Lord, I don't know. Yeah, I can hear you. I can hear you just fine. But it's
I got to figure out this IG when people try to call you thing.
Oh, yeah.
I'm like, stop calling me. I got things to do. I'm on IG live right now.
You're messing up my stuff. But
yeah.
For some reason, you're looking like really like pixelated.
Am I still pixelated on my side?
Yeah.
I remember there was a pause for a second, and then I was back. Should I try to jump off and jump back in?
Well, let's see. Wait a minute. Let me see.
Y'all tell me. You guys that are in the room. Do I? Yeah. Hey, Stefano. Am I pixelated on your side, Stefano? That's the last person I saw.
Yeah. Talk to.
Let me know if I'm pixelated. Am I moving like a robot?
Yes, you are. Like, I feel like I need to turn on so pixelated, but fine. Okay. Sanctuary said pixelated, but fine.
Oh, Teresa Sanctuary. Okay, cool. So I'm going to jump off and jump right back on. Just let me back in.
Okay, perfect. Perfect. All right. Just log back in, guys. Oh, well, actually, you end and then come back. All right, guys. So he's going to try to call me back, and then we'll see what the deal is. How y'all feeling? Y'all doing okay today? Hope you had a great Wednesday. Let's see. Praying that this is going to be better, this connection.
Yeah. Is that better?
Hey, there we go. There we go, man.
What's up, beautiful people? Am I still pixelated?
No. No.
Okay.
We see you.
Won't he do it?
We see each other.
We see each other.
We see each other. So look, so let's get into it, man. Well, before we get into it, how are you? And I mean that,
man,
heart to heart, how are you?
I'm really, really, really good.
That's good.
I'm really, really good. I'm so grateful that whatever this kind of internal spiritual journey was for me, I'm so thankful that it started a few years ago before 2020. Because what I learned and part of what we'll talk about, I think, today, if we have time, is I've learned how to find my alignment, to find my joy, to find my happiness internally. And so a lot of my life before, you know, I would be affected by so many things around me. And so mm-hmm. if you asked me how I was doing, it was based on what was going on. Mm-hmm. And now I as hard as I work in my craft and in my field and in my job, I work, if not more, at self-care, man. And so, you know, when I was younger, I grew up in church. And so, you know, old folks used to say things like, you know, this joy that I had, the world didn't give it.
And the world can't take it away.
And the world can't take it away. And so, you know, you don't know if that's true for yourself until you're tested. And you don't know if that's true for yourself until the world turns upside down. And so now we're in a space right now where we've got, you know, we've got COVID. It's literally a pandemic that I think is greater than like biblical proportions. You know what I'm saying? I mean, like literally the entire world is affected right now. Yes. It's not just us in America. It's not just us in New York or California. The entire world has been affected by this. And then on top of that, we have the civil unrest that's happening in America right now that, thank God, is also stirring things up and stirring the pot in other countries across the globe. So with all of that going on, I'm very clear that in order to maintain a level of sanity, yes, that's just number one. Yes. As a black man in America, just to maintain a level of sanity. Then on top of that, add to that a level of joy. Mm-hmm. It takes a ferocious discipline of self-care, a ferocious discipline of self-care and self-love.
Well, let me dig into that just a little bit more then. So like what kind of things, if you don't mind sharing, like what kind of things, and you don't have to share everything, but just what type of things is in your self-care arsenal?
Bruh, let's share all the things.
Listen,
get it for free before I charge for it. Listen, buckle up. You said we can get comfortable. Y'all take y'all shoes off. Let's go. Yes. So a couple years ago, I was doing Hamilton in New York, and it was a tumultuous time because I was in this space where...
Let me stop you. Guys, he wasn't doing Hamilton. He was George Washington in Hamilton. I just want to clarify because he's trying to play it small. He was George Washington in Hamilton.
Yeah. We had a good time. We had a real good time. But somebody said, share. All right, I got you. We're going to share. Get your pens and papers out. So essentially, I had a friend of mine, Allison Elizabeth Brown. Shout out to her. Great friend of mine from Baltimore. She came up to see the show, and we were out at a Thai restaurant. And she said something that just resonated so strongly for me. And so this is for every single person out there that feels stuck. And y'all know what I mean. Have you ever felt stuck in your life? It's not that things are horrible. It's not that things are bad. Sometimes they are. But the truth of the matter is you just feel stuck. You feel like everything's been like this. And she said she started to do some research and really start to study some of the spiritual people that she really followed and looked up to, but also some of the business people, Fortune 500 company members and things like that. And what she found, and as I began to study as well, is that a lot of the practices are the same.
Okay.
So today what we're going to talk about a little bit is a little bit of what I share when I do some motivational speaking, but sometimes I can't go that deep. But since we in your house with our shoes off, we're going to go deep.
Go.
So this is the thing, y'all. This is the thing. Thoughts become things. Literally, the couch that we were talking about that I'm sitting on was in somebody's mind.
Yes.
Thoughts become things. And so I can almost, to a degree, look at your life and tell you the kinds of thoughts you've been thinking. Yeah, there's a great scripture in the Bible that says, as a man thinketh, so is he. As a man thinketh, so is he. And so what I realized is a lot of what I was looking for and a lot of what I was asking for in my life is directly connected to my thought life first. So if the heart pumps blood through the body, the mind is the part of the body that creates.
Yes.
It creates, right? So start there. So what I realized is that as Allison was talking to me at this Thai food restaurant, she moved everything off the table. And she drew this picture on the table of a little man with this like big round head. So it was like a circle and a little body. And she basically said, every result in your life is connected to your mind. What people don't understand though, is that it's not just the conscious mind that creates, it's the subconscious mind that creates.
Come on now.
So it's all those things that are inside of you from childhood, from media, from social media, everything that you're putting in, the music you listen to, all of those things go into your thought life and begin to create and manifest the life that you have. So if you want to shift what your life looks like, this is for everybody out there that's tired, everybody out there that feels like they've been living the same kind of life. When you are ready to change, when you are ready for your life to look different, you have to change this.
Yes.
Now, let's get practical. What does that look like?
Yes.
What does that look like? We can talk about it from a, hey, Destiny, see you just joined. We can talk about it from a deep perspective, but honestly, if you want your life to look different and you want to manifest differently, you have to change the way you think. For me, I'm going to share my 7 steps.
Yes. It's
actually 7 steps. I'm going to share those things with you today. You find a way to make this your own thing. I did this for 90 days a few years ago. 90 days.
This is what I wanted to get into, obviously, because we were having dinner after we had just attended Hamilton, seeing you in one of your last shows before you were transitioning from New York to LA. And we had gone to dinner, me, you, Courtney, it was a whole group of us. We had gone to dinner and you were sharing these 7 steps.
Now, how many years ago? That was like 2-3 years ago?
Two years ago.
About 2 years ago?
Two and a half-ish.
So for those of you, again, out there who are ready for your life to look differently, this is actually a real testimony. Because 2.5 years ago, when we sat down to dinner, I wasn't living the life that I'm living right now. I manifested the life that I'm living right now. What I love about this conversation is 2.5 years ago, we left the stage door from Hamilton. And I told you what I was doing. And now 2.5 years later, we're having a conversation over Instagram. And I'm living in a house that I own with a pool right there. My dream car, a beautiful relationship, happier than I've ever been, connected to artistically people I respect so much. Like literally, it blows my mind that I'm working with some of the people that I've dreamed of working for.
And I'm going to stop you right there because, guys, he has been working with, oh my gosh, I can't even name all the names. Ava DuVernay, mm-hmm. Friends, your godmother is
Angela Bassett. Yeah, it's crazy.
Mary J. Blige, Neo, like the list goes, Brandy, you know, performed with Brandy. Like the list has gone on. So we're not talking about some fly by night guy who just is just out here, just whatever.
I receive all of that. I just want y'all to know that that it's not because I'm so special. That's what I want to share today. If even if it's just a select few people that ever see this, I want you to understand that you can manifest the kind of life that you want. And I'm going to give you the tools that somebody gave me. And you can do with it what you will. But at the end of the day, the life that I'm living right now, I saw it first. I saw, and y'all ain't seen nothing yet. I haven't seen nothing yet. But the life that I'm living now, I saw first. So these are some of the seven things that I think I shared with you 2.5 years ago that have helped me manifest this beautiful life that I have now. The first thing that I want everybody to understand is that it's really, really, really important to command your morning. Because in the morning is when you set the momentum for your day. And so when you wake up, I'll speak for myself. This is not prescriptive. This is like what I do for me that's changed my life. I just hope it changes your life too. So when I would wake up in the morning before, the first thing I would do is go to my to-do list. I'm a list person. So even if I didn't literally go to my phone or my calendar, when I wake up, my old habit was, what do I have to do today? The second thing that I would do is probably jump on social media. If it wasn't an email or calendar, which is what do I have to do today, the second thing I would do is start on social media. What's tricky about that space? Let me tell y'all what's tricky about that. What's tricky about that is if you wake up taking in somebody else's ideas, taking in somebody else's images, taking in somebody else's demands, you start the momentum of your day answering to other people's dreams and visions. Yeah.
That
answering to other people's dreams and visions. And so the momentum of your day starts to feel like you're chasing that, right? So for me, the first thing that I do as soon as I wake up is I write down 5 to 10 things I'm grateful for. We started the whole premise of this conversation off with, as a man thinketh, so is he. Yes. Thoughts become things. So when you start your day off in gratitude, it's almost like you're telling the universe, I have so much, give me more. because the universe responds to what you're thinking.
Yes.
So if you start off with lack and what you don't have, the universe doesn't know how to differentiate between that. So if you start off with lack or what I need to get done, the universe gives you more to get done.
Yes.
More lack. But if you start your day off having and you say, I'm going to write down 5 to 10 things I'm grateful for, all of a sudden it's like everything in the day starts to give you more of what to be grateful for. So I start off writing down 5 to 10 things I'm grateful for. And that's every day. I started this off 2.5 years ago.
Yep.
And my life is completely different. If you just do that, I'm not even gonna tell you the rest of I'm gonna tell you the rest of the 6 things. Yeah. If you just wake up though, if you just wake up in the morning and start your day off writing down 5 to 10 things you're grateful for, even if you're waking up and you already waking up to a rough day. I remember one day I woke up and I was like, what do I write down? I'm tired. What do I write down? Okay. I'm grateful that I can see. Oh my God, I'm grateful that I can see. And I sat with that thought for a second and I thought about the fact that there are so many people who can't. I thought about when I had a bad contact in my eye and how it jacked up my eye. How grateful I was that I could see. I started off with gratitude. So that's the first thing. Start off with gratitude. And even if you just have to start off with small things, believe me, law of attraction, somebody just wrote it. It'll give you more things to think about. So gratitude is the key to manifestation. We just have to start there. Yes. The key to manifestation is gratitude. Anything that we're asking for, write this down. I had to write it down. Anything that we're asking for, we believe we'll be happier in the having of it. Anything that we're asking for, praying for, waiting for, trying to manifest, we believe we'll be happier in the having of it.
Yes.
If you're asking for more money, it's because you believe you'll be happier when you get more money. If you're asking to move to a different place in your career, you believe you'll be happier. If you're asking for a relationship, you believe you'll be happier when that woman, that man, that whoever comes and joins you in your bed or in your life. So anything that you're asking for, you believe you'll be happier in the having of it. The biggest turning point for me was when I realized I had to get happy first and then the things will come.
Yes.
A lot of times you think that you have to get those things and then I'll be happy. So when the money comes, I'll be happy.
Yes.
When the person comes, I'll be happy. When the job comes, I'll be happy. The key is to get happy first. Once you realize that you are responsible for your own happiness, and you step into that every day,
yes,
every single thing that you think will make you happy will just come to you literally like a magnet. Yeah. I'm living it.
Yes.
Like a magnet.
Absolutely.
So the first thing I do is I write down what I'm grateful for. The second thing I write down is, and I did this again for 90 days. The second thing that I write down is three things I affirm about myself.
Mm-hmm.
I am statements. Especially as a Black man, you have a Black man and in this industry, you have every single person and every single thing in the world telling you who you are.
Coming against you,
brother.
Yes.
Who do you say you are?
Yeah.
So I write down, that's what matters. That's what matters. And so I remember I would write down what I'm grateful for, 5 to 10 things. And then one day it kind of moved past three things. I would say, I am worthy, I am wealthy, I am healthy, I am wise. I am worthy, I am wealthy, I am healthy, I am wise. And I would say it until I felt it.
You believe
me? Listen, you is smart, you is important.
Exactly.
Okay. So I would say it until I felt it. And then the next thing I would write down is declarative statements. So yeah. I declare, or I desire, or I want. Mm-hmm. I would write down those three things. So gratitude, affirmations, declarations. The next thing is a little bit of a tricky subject. And this is one thing I got from Allison. Write down, this again, for 90 days I did this. Three people you need to forgive.
My Lord, let's stop right there for a second. Because whenever you told me this, and you shared it with the table, and we were writing down all this stuff and, like, you know, going at it or whatever, and when I started to put it in action, that was, and it was kind of surprising to me, because I'm a very loving person, like, I lead with love, but I then began to think, whoa, I never forgave such and such for mm-hmm. doing me wrong for that 10 years ago. I forgot about it. I didn't forgive them though. Like the basic principle.
Yeah.
I didn't forgive them. And it was hard to write out names. And it was hard to write out situations and to relive it. And at some points I would even get caught up and stop there. Like I would just be like, you know what, today I don't know if I forgive them.
Yeah. And the thing that's important, and somebody just wrote this, they said something to the degree of that's a heart cleanse there. It's so true. Forgiveness is not for the other person. It's for you. And what I realize about manifestation is, and I say this when I meet a lot of students as well, the thing about it is if I give you what you're asking for, but you don't feel good on the inside, what's the point?
Yep.
And so holding unforgiveness is like holding negative energy in your body. If you've ever like hurt yourself or like torn a muscle or the muscle is sore, you lose mobility.
Yes.
In your body. You lose mobility in that space. And that's how unforgiveness works. A lot of people are praying for things. They walk in gratitude. They walk in affirmations. They walk in declaration. But they still can't quite manifest the thing they've been praying for. Sometimes it's because you still have unforgiveness in your heart. And so the thing that's been trying to come to you, it works like a block. So this negative energy is still in your body while you're praying for something positive. And that's why sometimes what you've been asking for is delayed. So that's the fourth thing I did for 90 days. I wrote down what I was grateful for, affirmations, declarations, and then three people you need to forgive. Now, this is where it gets deep. Around my second or third week, I remember one day I woke up and I said, okay, God, I've done my gratitudes. I've done all the other stuff. Forgiveness time. Who do I need to forgive? And I remember it was myself. It was myself. And for about two to three weeks, anytime I got to that forgiveness time in my morning discipline, it was me. And there were times that I did not forgive myself for the mistakes that I made, for not achieving certain things, for treating people a certain way. And what I realized is you can't become better until you first forgive who that person was that did all that. You got to let it go. You got to forgive yourself and let it go. And if you don't forgive yourself and don't let it go, you'll never manifest the person that you're trying to become.
It's all right. It's
so you got to release it. You got to release it. So after gratitudes, affirmations, declarations, forgiveness, the next thing, I need all the church people, church folks, come close. Church people. This was tricky for me, church people. After I forgave myself, the next thing I do in my morning practice, for 90 days I did this, and now it's just a part of what I do, is meditation. We as church people are taught how to pray. We're not taught how to meditate, even though the Bible tells us to meditate.
Yes.
And what I realized is prayer for a lot of us is a whole lot of talking. But if you want to grow and if you want to learn and if you want to manifest, you got to listen.
Yes. And people get caught up there because, you know, being a church boy myself, grew up in church literally all my life. There is a certain prayer. There's a certain type of prayer. There's certain languages that are used or certain language that's used in prayer, and it becomes a system, a cycle. And if you don't pray like that, then you're not really...
You ain't praying.
Your prayer hit the ceiling and fell right back on the floor. Your prayer did nothing. No sky. It ain't got no oil. It ain't anointed.
Listen, I heard this metaphor used, and I think it's the most beautiful thing about meditation. If you imagine one of those Christmas balls that you shake up, and it's got like a bunch of like a snow globe, right? When you shake it up, that's how your mind kind of works, right? So when you look into it, all you see is this stuff floating all over the place. But when you meditate, you get still, and all of that snow settles at the bottom, and then you can see clearly. Part of manifestation is being able to see it. If you can't see it, it's harder to manifest it. And meditation is getting still, getting quiet, and it will help you see clearly.
Absolutely.
It'll help you see clearly. Also, it's where you get the downloads, especially for those of us who are creative. Get still. It'll give you all the downloads you need. And so...
To listen, you got to be able to hear.
You got to hear.
To tune in that radio, like you got to. Yeah. You know, right now, yeah. You got all the snow and the globe, and you're looking all around, and it's fuzzy, and there's a bad connection. But as soon, like you said, as soon as it settles, you can see, and you can hear. You can get the download. It's clear. I'm sorry.
I love what you said. No, I love what you said about the radio, because I think that what we don't realize when it comes to manifestation is a lot of the things you've been praying for and asking for are actually already there and available to you. You're just on the wrong station.
Yes. Wrong frequency.
So you got to tune yourself to the frequency of the thing that you want. And so a lot of times I'll go, your favorite song is playing. And you'll go, I don't hear my favorite song. And I'll go, I told you it's on 92.3. And you go, oh, I'm on 102.5. That's why you can't hear it. So part of manifesting is learning how to meditate, because meditation will tune you to the thing that you want. This is something I didn't do for 90 days, but I'm gonna put this in my pocket real quick. Part of the way you get specifically what you're trying to manifest is tune yourself to the feeling of it. So in other words, whatever it is, like this house, I'll use this house as an example. A lot of people didn't know this, but I was looking in New York for about a year and a half at apartments. And I would go in and I would go, oh, this building is dope, but I don't really like the apartment. Or I would go, oh, this apartment is great, but it's dark in here. Oh, it's because it's in the middle of the courtyard. It was really hard for me to find what I was looking for. Did my morning practice one day. After meditation, I heard this still small voice say, write down how you want to feel when you walk into your home.
That's good.
So I wrote down all these details about how I wanted to feel in my home. I wanted to walk in and instantly feel peace. I wanted to walk into my home and feel space. I wanted to feel lots of light. I wanted to feel like I was on vacation. I remember I wrote it down. When I go home, I want to feel like I'm coming to vacation. Long story short, I was talking to a friend of mine, and she was like, have you thought about looking in LA? And I was like, I don't really know. I'm doing Broadway right now. She's like, well, I have a friend that was willing to work with me, and I had bad credit and no money. So I'm sure they're willing to work with you. So I said, cool.
You may need to slide that that friend over here.
I got you. So I hit this person up, and he's a realtor, and we were going to look at 7 places. I was going to be in L.A. for one day on a layover. And he was like, I'll set up 7 places. The second place I walked into, when I opened the door, I felt everything I wrote down.
Wow.
Everything I wrote down, I felt when I opened the door. That's how I knew this was the place for me.
Wow.
And so they said all these crazy things, like my mother being a mom, she was like, you know, they're going to rake you through the coals over your finances. You know, it's going to take 2 to 3 weeks. That was not the case for me. When you talk about manifestation, there's an ease and a flow that can happen in your life if you agree that that's how your life is supposed to go.
Yes.
So I was like, no, I was like, I hear you, Mom. I know that buying a house is difficult. Do you know that I literally found this house and it was mine in 2 weeks?
That's unheard of.
Unheard of. My realtor said, I've been doing this for 20-something years, and I've never closed on a house this fast. And I asked for $10,000 less than what they were offering. And they didn't even go back and forth with me. They were like, it's yours. Now, I'm not going to lie.
It's unheard of.
Bruh, unheard of. And I ain't going to lie, I'm human. So I was like, what's wrong with the house? If y'all going to give me this house this
quick,
yeah,
of course, yeah.
And $10,000, what's wrong with it? And so they did the inspection, and I remember the inspection guy came up to me and shook my hand, and he said, sir, I want to tell you something. I said, what? He said, you've got a great house on your hands. I say all that to say, there was something, and now this one is for all my not even just church folks, but my Black folks out there. Black folks. There's something that we've agreed to that is a lie. And this is not just Black folks. I just know as a Black person, we do this.
Yes.
I do this.
Specifically,
we agree that victory is on the other side of hardship. We agree no pain, no gain. We agree that if we want something great, we got to work hard for it.
Yes.
I'm going to say something that's controversial.
Go ahead, say it.
That's not always true. It's true because we believe it's true. I'm going to give you an example. I always said to myself, I had that Will Smith mentality. You might be more talented than me, but you won't outwork me.
Won't outwork me. Yes.
I will run harder on the treadmill. I'll run faster. When I auditioned for Motown, mm-hmm. When I first did the workshop, I was in the ensemble. I really wanted to be Marvin Gaye. I had my eye on the role. We did another workshop. They let me audition. I became Marvin Gaye. After that, I had to wait about 3 or 4 months before we went to Broadway.
Yes.
During that waiting period, I was like, okay, they'll call me and tell me I'm Marvin Gaye. The director was like, I'll call you. Not a word. They went and auditioned around the country. I even heard through the grapevine, no pun intended, that they even offered it to a few R&B singers. Right?
Okay.
And I was like, yikes. Long story short, the day before we started rehearsal, the Friday before the Monday, I was like, are they finally going to let me know? They said, you're going to be in the show. We just don't know who you're going to be, but we'd like you to come back in and audition again. So I had waited months and had to re-audition and found out the Friday before the Monday rehearsal that I finally got it. When I auditioned for Hamilton, I auditioned 7 times.
7.
Now, when I look back at it, it was really just 2 rounds of auditions, but how many times I actually got up and had to go in the room and see people was 7 times. And I remember it wasn't until this year I was praying about this and God said, like literally I was meditating, I just heard his voice and it was like, you have agreed. Actually, this was the end of last year. It was like, there's an agreement that you've made with yourself. And part of you likes it. Part of you likes overcoming adversity so that you can look back and say, see, I worked for that.
It becomes a part of your narrative.
It becomes a part of your narrative. And so some of us, as people of color, have made a part of our narrative that life needs to be hard. And once life is hard and difficult, if I achieve something great, I deserve it because I came through hardship. But that is something we have agreed to. So I said, I'm gonna test it. All this stuff that I'm talking about, y'all, test it and hit me in my DM and let me know how I go.
Mm-hmm.
I remember this was probably in the fall of last year. I said, I'm gonna test this. The next thing I get, I want to come to me through ease and flow. I want it to be easy. Ease and flow. ease and flow. My prayer for myself is ease and flow. I done worked hard. Life has been hard. I want something to come through ease and flow. And the next job that I got was a direct offer from Ava DuVernay.
What? See, y'all.
She just called.
If y'all don't catch this, I don't know what I don't know.
And it was crazy because I ain't never got no. I mean, I may have gotten a direct offer at some point, but definitely not from no Ava. Yes. And so
Ava DuVernay.
The Ava. And I have so much respect for the work that she does and for who she is as an artist. And so it meant so much more to receive that. But what's interesting about it is it was a conversation and a game between me and God. Yeah. It was a conversation and a game between me and my journey. And I said, I've worked so hard for everything. I want the next thing that I get to be easy. And literally, she texted me and she said, congratulations, the last conversation we had, I remember you said I keep making you a bad guy, so I'm gonna let you be a good guy this time. And I was a therapist in this episode of Cherish the Day. And it was crazy. And Wendy Raquel Robinson was the therapist right before me in that episode. And I had ran into her in LA. And it was just such confirmation of the journey that God had brought me through. And after I shot that episode, I went, oh my gosh, it's real.
You were a good guy.
But I had agreed. It's whatever agreement you make with yourself. I had made an agreement with myself that everything doesn't have to be hard. That sometimes God can just open doors and open windows. And when I thought about it, I told my homeboy, he's actually my cousin, an amazing musician, by the name of Dante Winslow. And Dante said to me, the last time he was at my house, he said, have you ever noticed that when God does things, it's always easy? And I was like,
it's so
true. Actually true, because the circumstances are hard. I mean, literally, I'm running. I got an army behind me. Pharaoh's army is behind me.
Yes.
I don't have no battle strategy. I don't have no exit plan for the children of Israel. I'm standing at this water. And what does God say, do? Just stretch out your rod. Use this in your hand. Just stretch out your rod. We're so used to things being difficult that we make it something else. It's like, oh my gosh, there's giants in the land. You told me that that's the city I'm supposed to occupy. It's the city of Jericho. They have walls that are impenetrable. So are you going to give me like the strategy of like how to like take my hammer and nails and dismantle the system and dismantle the walls? And God is like, no, just walk around it 7 times and sing some praises. And the walls will come tumbling down. We need to apply that to our lives. There are some of us who have had a very hard life, and we continue to have a hard life because we have made an agreement with ourselves that life is going to be hard, and that is not always true.
It's not always true, and thank you for actually putting it in those words, because I didn't have what you just said, those words, but I'd say about 6 to 8 months ago, Courtney and I were talking. We sit on the couch. And business is good. You know, things are going good. We're doing this shoot for this brand, doing this for this brand. And I said, sweetheart, I want to travel. Like, I want to actually travel. Like, I want us to be on this shoot, this place, this shoot, this place. We got to do a shoot in California. We got to do this. When I tell you one week later, we get an email. Hey, would you guys be interested in doing this shoot in Florida? What?
That's how it works.
Are you joking? And it was back to back to back to back until COVID hit. And then after COVID hit, it's still going to be back to back to back to, because I agree with that. That's what I said.
That's what you said. And you believed it. You agreed to it, right?
And
so I think that when I talk about the process, like this is, again, I'm just sharing what I did for 90 days that started me on this journey. After meditation, I find a way to give every day. I find a way to give every day. So whether that's a compliment, whether that's a dollar, whether that's a smile, I find a way to intentionally give every day. Those of us who grew up in church, especially if they was always asking for tithes and offering, we understood the law of giving very quickly.
You do.
We do. We understand the law of giving. So I ain't going to talk about that too long. We get it. But basically, if you give, it will be given back to you. That is just the truth. If you are a giver, life will give back to you. And I'm telling you, I am a living witness of that. I'm a huge giver. And I don't say it to boast. I say it because it feels good.
Yeah, it feels good.
It feels good to give. It feels amazing to give. And so again, gratitude, affirmations, declarations, forgiveness, yes. Meditation, find a way to give every day. And yes. Then the last thing I'm going to say can be controversial. The last thing that I did for 90 days, number 7, I put myself first.
Come on now.
Now, the reason why I talk so much about giving is because it sounds like it's a contradiction to put yourself first. Mm-hmm. But speaking about traveling, when you travel a lot, they always say on the airline to put the oxygen mask
on yourself first.
On yourself first. Because even if I'm trying to help a toddler, but I can't breathe, I'll be passing out trying to do a very simple task.
Yes.
And some of us are that way, though. We give to our lovers, our friends, our jobs, and we are depleted. You have not spent any time giving to yourself. And so you're giving to everybody else from literally like the dust that yeah. you have left.
Yeah.
But if you learn how to fill your cup first, as a matter of fact, if you do these 7 steps, as soon as you wake up in the morning, you've already given to yourself first. Iyanla Van Zant says it like this. She says, my cup runneth over. It's a scripture in the Bible, right? My cup runneth over. Everything outside of the cup is for everybody else.
Else. Yes.
Everything inside of the cup is for me. I'm going to give you another example. If I ask you to help me to move, now all of us who are of a certain age, you know, something about those 20s and 30s, we move, right? So you're always asking a friend to help you move. Here's the thing. If I slept that night, had coffee in the morning, all my coffee drinkers, you understand what I'm saying? Until we got that first cup, we're not always the best people to be around.
Yeah, it's just...
Unless I do that and then show up with the energy of wanting to help you move into this new space, I'm actually not helping you. Because if you try to help me move and you dropping my boxes, slamming my stuff, huffing and puffing, I'd rather you take care of yourself and yes. then come and help me. Because when you listen yes. to music, y'all laughing, y'all reminiscing, and you moving, literally sometimes you can move and it feels like that. You feel like, oh my gosh, we move so fast.
Yeah.
How do we move your whole apartment from here to there and it happened that fast and we had a good time? Because yeah. we came in a positive space. We came with positivity. We took care of ourselves first, and that's how you do it. So those are my 7 steps. These are the things that I did for 90 days.
90 days.
And I'm trying to tell you everything. I'm not even being facetious. Everything in my life changed.
Yo.
Everything.
So listen, I'm going to go one more time, guys. So it's gratitude, mm-hmm. affirmations, mm-hmm. declarations, forgiveness, meditation, give, and put yourself first.
I did it for 90 days. And what's crazy is I have some friends that, and we do this together, we still have a gratitude chain. Mm-hmm. And so when I wake up in the morning, because they're on the East Coast and I'm here, I wake up in the morning and they've already in our text message written down their gratitudes. And it's just a way for us to keep each other accountable. But it's been going on now for 2+ years. So for 2+ years, I wake up with other people's gratitude. It's beautiful. And I have to honestly say that the biggest blessing that I've gotten from manifestation is that I am extremely happy. It's not about the stuff. It's not about the stuff. The stuff is a reflection of what's going on the inside. And I'm excited to get up every day because I'm excited to choose joy. It's literally a tattoo on my wrist. Choose joy.
Choose joy. Wow.
And that's wow. the thing. It's a choice. It's a choice. And that's not to say, let's also get real for a second. That's not to say that things aren't going to happen. Like, let's look at what's happening in the world right now.
Yeah.
They're going to be negative things. They're going to be things that are the polar opposite of all this positivity and joy and love and manifestation that we're talking about. Even those things will work for your good. When you step into this place of wholeness and alignment, you even look at negative situations as positive. And this is why. There is nothing that happens in my life that I don't learn from, grow from, or doesn't push me forward.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes when you experience something negative, it clarifies for you
yes.
the positive thing that you want. There are things now in my life that I prayed for when I was younger that mm-hmm. I didn't get, and I'm so happy I didn't. I'm so happy I didn't, because who I was needed certain things to validate who I am. And I look at a lot of my friends or people that I just know who have gotten some of the things that I thought I wanted, and I've watched what their life is, and they aren't more happy than me. They don't have as much freedom as I have, and I've watched them tumble and fall.
Yeah.
Tumble and fall. And yeah. What I realize is sometimes there are vain glories, there are vain things that we want because we haven't spent the time doing this inner work, and you don't realize that you're actually the wealthy one. While it seems like everybody else has got it going on, believe it or not, you're the one with the most peace. You're the one with the most joy. You're the one with the most freedom. And we look outside of ourselves for validation, but when you start to do this work, it's like God will allow the whole universe to reflect back to you who you really are. And when you step into that, you won. Like, there's nothing that can come in your life that will ever give you that. So I thought about it, like, in my phone, right? It's a great example. In my phone, right? And I'm not saying awards are bad, but in my phone, almost like a vision board, when you open my phone, you'll see an Emmy, a Grammy, an Oscar, and a Tony.
Hey.
Right? An EGOT, right? And I had the great pleasure of spending time with Whoopi Goldberg, and she took me to the space in her house where she has her Emmy, her Grammy, her Oscar, her Tony. And I would ask her a bunch of questions about, like, did your whole career change when you got these awards? Did your life change? And the answer is no. No. And I thought about when I left her house, I really thought about the fact that I gave value to golden statues that white men created to congratulate themselves.
Wow.
I was giving value to golden statues that white men created to congratulate themselves. And it's not so much that I'm downing the award, because I believe that the awards have become something else.
Yeah, absolutely.
It's a way for us as peers to peers. It's a way for us to look at our work and celebrate our work. Right. But at the end of the day, you should be doing that anyway.
Exactly.
So if you get the award is a reflection of that work and that value that you've already been walking in.
Yeah. Yeah.
When I did When They See Us with Ava, I just knew that she was going to sweep the entire award season. I just knew it was going to sweep. And it didn't.
They didn't.
At the end of the day, that's not the power of the piece anyway.
Oh, it's not. It's not. It's not. That's
not the purpose of the piece.
They saw us. They saw
when that woman stepped down from Columbia University, the lawyer who was responsible for taking these young men's lives and destroying them, and then she went on to make millions of dollars from books, and then she's out there teaching all these other young people. When that woman had to step down from all of those boards of those nonprofits, when she had to step down from being the voice of education for lawyers in this country, when she was removed from her position, that is why the show is made.
That is it.
That is way more powerful than a golden statue.
That's the award.
That's the award. And I think that when we reevaluate who we are, why we do what we do, and why we're here, you'll step into alignment with that, and then your life will reflect that. And if awards come, praise the Lord, cool, let's party, let's have a good time. Thank you for my peers, you know, acknowledging me. Cool. But if the work is not connected to your purpose and why you're here and why you do what you do, it's all vain. It's all vain.
What's the point? My brother. Are you guys getting anything out of this? You gotta be. Because I'm over here blessed. I'm like getting ready to catapult out of this seat, run around this apartment, like literally. So
yeah, bro.
I want everyone on this call to know and understand that it happens in the mind. It starts in the mind. So just like my brother Bryan was saying, first thing in the morning, you know, and I'm not always great at this, but first thing in the morning to set an intention to really focus on gratitude, and then declarations, and then the declarations, and then the, like, it becomes easier over time.
Can I tell you another thing that I just thought of why in the morning it's important? And I know that some people are better at night than they are in the morning, but this is why I believe the morning is important. If I push a car down the hill, or if I push a big boulder down the hill, as it goes down the hill, it gains momentum. It gains speed. So if I start my day off with positivity and it starts rolling down the hill, it's not that negative things won't happen during the day. But when they do, it's getting ran over. It's getting ran over because I've already built momentum of positivity. So negative things will happen. I'm not saying that you're going to live your life and it's always going to be rainbows. But when the negative things happen, they won't impact you the same way, because literally the momentum of the positive energy and thought that you've had going rolls right over top of it. And I'm like, oh, dang, that person, I guess that person did have attitude. I didn't even notice. Oh, wow, my order was wrong. It's okay. It's okay, sister. Don't, you know, be so hard on yourself. Guess what? I got time. We can change the order. It's all good. Or you brought me the wrong order, and guess what? I like what I got here better than what I ordered. So there's always a silver lining. My mother, as a minister, would say this scripture that I think is so true. All things work together for good. And it's the truth.
Work. Yes.
All things are working for your good. Every single thing is working for your good.
But it's so easy to think that all things are working against you whenever it looks like all things are working against you. But, you know, like you're saying, you know, if in your mind you've already started that momentum, you've already that momentum has already built up over the course of the day. It can't knock you off course.
Like, you can't knock you off course.
I mean, you can dip and dive on that one. You can matrix on that.
What's also kind of great about it is once you start this practice for yourself, you don't even have to overthink it. That's what's cool about it. For those of us who are heady and get stuck in our heads about things, once you start doing this inner work on yourself, whatever it looks like for you, for me, it's those 7 steps. But even if it's not that for you, once you start doing whatever your personal spiritual practice is, you won't even have to think about this stuff. It literally becomes second nature. I've trained my brain to be grateful and to look for things that I appreciate. So naturally, my day is so full of so many positive things because I've trained my brain. I'm not even doing it on purpose now. I just show up ready to serve, and I show up ready to appreciate. Wow. And then God blesses me.
Wow.
And that's how my life works.
So listen, I'm gonna be closing soon, but like there's somebody who, you know, either they're watching this right now or they will watch it, you know, as it replays, and they're struggling in this area. They're struggling either with manifestation, they're struggling with, you know, keeping a positive mindset, or just being grateful because we've been hit all these many times over the course of this quarantine. Like, what do you say to that person?
I say, be gracious and kind to yourself. We don't say that enough. We are so hard on ourselves. If you're having a bad day, that's okay. If you're not feeling great, that's okay. Acknowledge it. The second thing that's coming to my spirit is it's okay to ask for help. That's the other thing. We as people of color, and especially as men of color, we don't always seek therapists and counselors and ministers or even friends. We don't always say, hey, I'm not in a good place right now. Let me call my brother. Randomly, you came across my mind. I just got to be honest. I'm not doing too good. Something just told me to reach out. So I would say, if you're not in the place quite yet to do this kind of work, to come into alignment and to walk in positivity and manifestation, if you're just exhausted, it's okay to be tired. It's okay to rest. And most importantly, it's okay to ask for help. You don't got to do this whole thing by yourself. There is help for you. And now that we have technology,
yes,
you ain't even got to have all the answers. Google what you need.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
There is help for you. Don't feel like you're alone, because you're definitely not alone. And it's okay not to be okay. And that's real talk. It's okay not to be okay.
It is. So look, brother, they about to kick me off of this thing. I just want to tell you, I love you.
Love you too.
You're amazing. I want to bring you back and talk a little bit more in detail about this. So I'm going to be hitting you back again.
That's right.
I pray that you have found some answers about manifestation and how you can live your best life. All right. So look, God bless you. Thank you so much. Peace and many blessings to you. And
thank you, brother.
See you soon, brother.
Peace. God bless all y'all. Bless y'all.
Yes.